Let's work through the following optimization problem together. The directions state a rectangular storage container with an open top is to have a volume of 10 cubic meters. The length of its base is twice the width. Material for the sides costs $6 per square meter. Material for the base costs $10 per square meter. Find the cost of the cheapest such container. Okay, so we know this is an optimization problem because we're trying to optimize some quantity. That is, either find the maximum or the minimum value for some quantity. In this case, we're trying to find the cost of the cheapest such container. So we want to minimize the cost function for this container. Okay, so on a previous slide, you saw steps for solving optimization problems. So we're going to follow those steps in this video. So the first step is to read the problem carefully. Okay, so we've already done that. So then next, you want to draw a picture to kind of summarize the information and then establish any relevant variables and name those variables. So I already have a picture here. So we have a rectangular storage container, and it has an open top. Okay, and we're told about its volume. So, but what are the relevant variables here? So it says the length of its base is twice its width. Okay, so that's why we have 2W here. The length of the base is twice its width, right? So 2W long and W wide. Okay, so we're using W then to represent the width of the container. So then what else? Well, the container also has a height, right? That's another important dimension of this rectangular shape. And so I've represented that height by the letter X here. All right, so we've established the variables in our problem. And next, the next step in the process is to identify the function you're trying to optimize and then write an equation for it in terms of your variables. Okay, so what are we trying to optimize here? Okay, well, if we scroll back up, remember the problem says we want to find the cost of the cheapest such container. The cost, the cheapest cost. So what we're trying to actually minimize here is a cost function. Okay, so then what that means is that we actually need to write the cost function for producing this container. Okay, so let's reread what it says about that. So it says materials for the sides cost $6 per square meter, and material for the base costs $10 per square meter. Okay, so square meters, these are units of area, right? So the sides cost $6 per unit of area, and then the base costs $10 per unit of area. So we need to basically figure out an expression for the area of each side. So let's work on doing that. Okay, so first let's be careful about our sides here. Okay, so as far as the sides of the container, I'm going to outline them here for us. There's two sides that are the same size, right? This front side and then this back side as well, right? This side back here would be the same size, right? The front and the back are the same size. So let's write an expression for that. Okay, so this is going to be my cost, and I'm going to call it C. Okay, so we've got 2 times, right, the area of the front and back, which the area is just going to be the length times the height of that, so 2WX. Okay, so that's the area, but remember the cost is actually $6 per unit area. So now I need to multiply this by 6 to get the actual cost. Okay, so that goes along with the sides I outlined in blue up here. But there's other sides, right? We've got these two end pieces that I'm going to outline in red. So this piece and this piece, and those are the same size as well, right? So I'm going to have another plus 2 times something. Okay, so what's the area of those sides? Well, that's just WX, right? And then once again, the material for the sides is $6 per unit area, so I need to multiply this by 6 as well. Okay, so there's one more piece I need to think about, and that's the base. We also have to pay to make the base of this container. All right, so plus, well, there's just one base, right? Because it's open, it's an open container. So what's the area of the base? Well, it's going to be 2W times W, so 2W squared. But what does a base cost? Remember, material for the base costs $10 per square meter. So this is going to be times 10. Okay, so next it's probably a good idea to clean this up a little bit. So what do we have? From this first term, we've got 6 times 4, so 24WX plus 12WX plus 20W squared. So that gives us a cost function of 36WX plus 20W squared. All right, so now we've written our equation that we actually want to optimize. So what's the next step in our process? The next step is to identify the constraint or constraints equation. So there's always going to be some sort of additional information given to you in these optimization problems that's going to allow you to write this constraint equation. So what else are we told here? Okay, so we're building this rectangular storage container with an open top. It is to have a volume of 10 cubic meters, right? So that's a constraint. We're not building just any rectangular storage container. Our storage container has to have a volume of 10 cubic meters. So somehow we have to incorporate that information into our work. And then the rest of the problem here tells us about the cost, which we've already made equations for. So we want the volume to equal 10 cubic meters. This is our constraint. But let's actually write that in terms of the variables that we've established. Okay, so volume in general is length times width times height, but using our variables, what does that give us? Well, the length is 2W, the width is W, and the height is X, right? So this is 2W times W times X, which is 2W squared X. So I've got volume equals 2W squared X. But remember, we want our volume to actually equal 10. So this is our actual constraint here. 2W squared X must equal 10. Okay, but how do we actually use that? Well, the next step in the optimization problem tells us. The next step says that we use the constraint to eliminate all but one independent variable of the optimization function, right? So remember, I'm trying to optimize cost up here. But I only want to have one independent variable ultimately in this equation, because I don't know how to take the derivative with respect to multiple variables at this point. But right now I have a W and an X as independent variables. But what I can do is I can use this constraint equation to eliminate one of those variables. Okay, and the way you're going to do that is just within this constraint equation, just solve for something. So in this case, it's going to be a little bit easier to solve for X. So I'm going to solve for X in this equation. I'm going to get X equals 10 over 2W squared, which if I simplify is 5 over W squared. Okay, so now I can take that expression for X and plug it in for X in my cost function. Okay, so if I actually do that, then I'm going to get C equals 36WX is what we had before, but X is 5 over W squared. And then plus 20W squared. Okay, and so 36 times 5 is going to give us 180. And then you're going to have W over W squared. So that's 180 over W plus 20W squared. So now this is my cost function with only one independent variable. And I use a constraint equation to do that. So the next step in the process is to identify the interval of interest for your independent variable. Now, sometimes that interval will be given to you explicitly in the problem, But often instead, you're just going to have to think about what values of the variable make sense. So my independent variable in this case is W. I need to think about what values of W make sense in this problem. Okay, so I'm thinking about a physical situation here, right? I'm building a rectangular storage container. A W represents the width of that container. So what values of W make sense? Well, I can't have a width of 0, right? Or less than 0. My width must be greater than 0. That makes sense. Okay, what about an upper bound? Well, I can make the width as big as I wanted to. So my upper bound is just going to be infinity. W has to be less than infinity. Okay, so I have some bounds on my variable now. So now that we have our constraint equation in terms of one variable and our interval of interest, we're ready to move on to the final step, which is actually to find the absolute max or min of this function on this interval, right? Because that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to optimize this quantity. That means find the absolute max or min. Okay, so if you remember how to do that, I want to find the absolute minimum in this case. And I'm on an open interval. So I'm definitely going to want to take the derivative, right? The derivative is going to tell me where any local mins or maxes are, and then I'll go from there. So let's take the derivative of this function. So first of all, I'm going to write it as 180w to the negative 1 plus 20w squared, and then we can find the derivative of that. Okay, so I'm going to take the derivative with respect to w, so bring the negative 1 down, I'm going to get negative 180 w to the negative 2 plus 40w, which I can write as negative 180 over w squared plus 40w. Okay, so here's my derivative. Okay, so now what do we do next? Remember, we're doing optimization sorts of things. I want to know where my critical points are. Those are going to be important, where any possible local max or mins are. So let's find the critical points. Okay, so remember, critical points are where the first derivative does not exist or is equal to 0. So are there any places where this derivative does not exist? Well, it doesn't exist at w equals 0, right? So c prime of 0 is undefined. But if I think back a few steps, remember that we said our interval of interest was for w between 0 and infinity and not including 0. So 0 isn't actually in my interval of interest, so I don't need to worry about it. So, but 0 is not in the interval from 0 to infinity, so I don't actually care. Okay, so what else? I need to set the derivative equal to 0 to solve for any other critical points. So if I do that, I end up with this equation. Okay, I'm going to move the 180 to the other side, multiply by w cubed and divide by 40, and I get this. This reduces to 9/2. So we get w equals the cubed root of 9/2. Okay, so what have we found so far? We found that there's one critical point. Okay, so remember a theorem that we learned last lesson. Actually, it might have been two lessons ago. But what we said is if we're trying to find the absolute max or min on an open interval, which is what we're doing here, right? We're trying to find the absolute extrema, and we're on an open interval in this case, from 0 to infinity. Okay, so if you're trying to do that, and there's only one local extrema on that open interval, then that local extrema is an absolute extrema, either an absolute max or min, depending on, you know, what the situation is. Okay, so we do have just one critical point here. So we want to answer the question, is it a local max or min? Okay, and there's several ways you could do that. You could use a first derivative test. You could use a second derivative test. In this case, let's practice using the second derivative test. Okay, so to use a second derivative test, we, of course, need to take the second derivative. All right, so if you remember, let me rewrite the first derivative up here. The first derivative was negative 180w to the negative 2 plus 40w. Okay, so if I take the second derivative then, I'm going to get 360w to the negative 3 plus 40. So 360 over w cubed plus 40. Okay, so remember to complete the second derivative test, you evaluate the second derivative at the critical point of interest. So here I want to evaluate the second derivative at cubed root of 9/2. Okay, so if I plug that in here, it's going to give me 360. Well, something cubed, the cubed of a cubed root, those things cancel out, right? So it's going to be 360 over 9/2 plus 40. Well, I don't care what the actual value here is. I just care if it's positive or negative. So this is greater than 0. Okay, so the fact that the second derivative is greater than 0 there means that the function is concave up, right? So that means my critical point is a local min. Okay, so there's a local min at w equals a cubed root of 9/2. Okay, so once again, what this theorem tells us, this theorem about absolute extrema on an open interval, so since we have only one critical point, this local min is the absolute minimum. Okay, so we know that we have a local min at w equals a cubed root of 9/2. So it seems like we've pretty much finished the problem, but it's always a good idea just to go back and make sure you've actually asked the question that was asked. So let's make sure that we've done that. So what is it actually asking? Find the cost of the cheapest such container. Okay, so we're looking to minimize that cost function. But what do we actually want to report? We actually want to report the cost. Okay, so we found where that minimum cost occurs for the W that minimum cost occurs at, but we actually want to give the minimal cost. Okay, so our cost function was 180 over W plus 20W squared. So then the minimum cost is going to be what I get when I plug in this point we found to the cost function. Okay, and I don't actually have a value for this. You could, if you were interested, find it on your calculator. But whatever this value is the minimum cost to building the container with the specifications we are given.